Thank you so much, Brett. Thank you all for joining us today. It's super exciting to see that we have folks from all over, from Washington, Texas, Oahu in Hawaii, to Oregon and South Africa, and others. Thank you for coming to join us today. I am Dr. Lizzie Mcleod. I lead the Nature Conservancy's global reef work. My team and I have spent decades working on coral reef protection, management, and restoration in reef regions around the world. TNC's coral reef work impacts over 80% of the world's coral reef nations. We have a wonderful program today, and we're going to focus on the beauty and the unique Palmyra Atoll. Joining us, we have Dr. Sylvia Earle, President and Chairwoman of Mission Blue. We have Bryce Gork, founder of Living Oceans Production and a Hope Spot champion, and Chad Wiggins, director of the Nature Conservancy's Palmyra program. We're going to be tackling some important topics today about ocean health and the importance of atoll systems, and we'd love to hear from you. So please make sure you type your questions in the chat, and through this process, we'll do our best to answer as many of them as we can. Before I formally introduce our panelists, I wanted to provide some background about the Nature Conservancy and Ocean and Mission Blue's oceans work. Many of you know TNC for our land conservation. What you may not know is that we've been doing marine conservation for over four decades. We have a range of strategies from marine protected areas to fisheries management, policy work, and working on improving the ocean health through improving marine management and restoration as well, and supporting coastal communities. We have an ambitious decadal target over the next decade. We're working to protect 4 billion hectares of ocean. The Nature Conservancy first acquired Palmyra over 20 years ago because of its global importance supporting healthy marine life. Palmyra's pristine waters hold some of the highest coral diversity and shark density and other predators in the Central Pacific. A fun fact about Palmyra is that it's over 1,000 miles to the nearest large population center, which is Honolulu, Hawaii. Mission Blue, Dr. Earle's organization, works to rally local and international communities around support for hope spots like Palmyra, with the ultimate goal of converting them into marine protected areas. Mission Blue's vision is to increase the official protection of the ocean from 6% today to 30% by 2030. And you're going to be hearing a lot about hope spots today, so I wanted to just take a minute to make sure that you know what they are. These are special places that are critical to the health of our oceans. Some of them are formally protected like Palmyra, but others of them still are in need of protection. And under Dr. Earle's leadership and the Mission Blue team, they've launched a global effort to shed light on these vital ecosystems and ignite the support that's so essential to secure them. So it's my pleasure now to introduce you to our speakers. First, Dr. Sylvia Earle, President and Chairwoman of Mission Blue and National Geographic Society Explorer in Residence. Sylvia is sometimes called her deepness by the New Yorker and the New York Times, a living legend by the Library of Congress, and the first hero for our planet by Time Magazine. Sylvia is an inspiration to me and many of us who are joining in today, but she's also an oceanographer, an explorer, an author, a lecturer. She has a career as a research scientist, government official, and director for both nonprofit and corporate organizations. Bryce Gork is an ocean entrepreneur with over two decades of experience leading initiatives on ocean health, fisheries, and culture through both film and private enterprise. Bryce is the founder of Living Ocean Productions and Ocean Preservation Alliance, and he is also a Mission Blue Hope Spot champion for Palmyra Atoll. Many of the images that we're going to share with you today are actually from Bryce. Chad Wiggins has worked in marine science in the Pacific since 2001. He led marine conservation efforts for the Nature Conservancy in Hawaii from 2008 to 2018. And since 2019, he's led our work in Palmyra Atoll, including our Climate Adaptation Resilience Lab. Chad's work focuses on building ecosystem resilience while also supporting colleagues and partners to find scientific discoveries from Palmyra that can help us improve our coral reef conservation efforts around the world, while also building the next generation of conservation leaders. Chad believes that Palmyra's story of connection, resilience, adaptation, and diversity inspire all of us to care for our oceans and our islands by doing whatever we can, wherever we live. So we wanted to take a minute now to start this event, to kick it off by sharing a 3-minute video that was actually developed by Bryce to introduce you to Palmyra, to take you underwater and to showcase its beauty. The video is narrated by Tom Hanks. We hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. Our planet and its resources are being pushed to new limits. And while we've become more globally connected, the balance between humans and the rest of nature is more fragile than ever. In search of this balance, there are few places that serve as a better example. Rising out of the middle of the Pacific Ocean lies Palmyra Atoll, host to one of the world's most pristine and fully intact marine and terrestrial ecosystems.
Palmyra Atoll is one of the ocean's best-kept secrets, a big blue hope spot in the Pacific Ocean.
But it wasn't always this way. For a brief period during World War II, we reshaped the atoll to serve a military need. But luckily, this tenure was short-lived. Virtually left alone for 70 years, Palmyra Atoll has restored its balance all on her own.
Here in Palmyra, you can see it all come together. The land, the ocean, the wildlife. It's just the way the world actually is. It's connected. A big blue hope spot.
In this astonishing place, every bird, tree, fish, and manta ray are interconnected and reliant on each other to survive. For the first time ever, we explore Palmyra's lush tropical forests and dive deep into her crystal clear seas, discovering how this dynamic ecosystem works. Palmyra Atoll makes it easy to see nature in harmony, and through its exquisite example, inspires us to reconnect with the natural world in our communities and even in our own backyards. With Palmyra as our muse, this film tells a story of resilience, interdependence, and hope.
Thank you so much for that, Bryce. Great job. That was so awesome. I get blown away every time I see it. Sylvia, I know I was watching you smile watching that as well. I know it was taking you back to your memories being underwater there. I'd love, Sylvia, for you to start us off by sharing what is so special to you about Palmyra and why is it so important as a hope spot?
I have a dog in the background who's cheering us on. So that's Sadie. Say hi, Sadie. Yeah. Anyway, what is special about Palmyra? Well, the message, I think, in that film is cause for hope. Here's a place that was undisturbed until the middle of the 20th century, when, because of the war interests, paradise was not lost, but really suffered some damage. It's a story of recovery now in the 21st century, that nature is resilient, not infinitely so. The scars still remain. But what I find so inspiring about Palmyra is how when you give nature a break, just let the creatures do their thing, recovery is possible. And around the world, there are places that have been damaged, not necessarily because of wartime interests, but just because humans appear to be waging war on nature in so many ways, converting so much of the natural world to our own purposes that in some cases, many cases, seem like a good idea at the time. Looking at now at our impact on the world as a whole, we need to look at examples such as Palmyra and understand that if we really take action to give some of these natural systems a chance to recover, we can see not only better health for the ocean, but it translates directly to a better health for us. Certainly, we're looking now at climate as a major issue. We need the natural systems, looking at the carbon cycle, looking at what it takes to maintain Earth in a hospitable way. Palmyra, to me, is just a beacon of hope.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. Bryce, I'd love to hear from you as a Hope Spot champion. Palmyra is obviously a special place in your heart as well, and I would just love to hear your thoughts on why it's so important for all of us. You're muted, Bryce.
I'm sorry. Aloha, everyone. Good morning. You know, for me, Palmyra is the ultimate hope spot. I mean, I get excited every time I talk about it. I feel so grateful I even got to go there. You know, it's such a wild, wild place in the middle of the Pacific. And, you know, the ocean feels so wild there. The animals feel so wild there. And the land has this epic vibe. It's like soft and welcoming when you get there. I think everyone on our team felt it in some way, and we talked about it every single day, actually. You know, there's this peaceful feeling you get when you're in a place where nature is firing. And Palmyra is just that. You know, it's everything I've learned about it. It's this full functioning system where you can actually witness how the land and the sea are connected. I was going to give a little overview of this, how that cycle works there. Chad, feel free to correct me if I miss a link here. But, you know, the story of Palmyra starts with the birds. They go off, feed offshore on the fish, come back to their nests in native Pisonia trees, and poop out their meals onto the soil and the shoreline, which ends up washing back into the sea. And that then feeds the plankton. And the plankton go on to feed the smaller fish and the manta rays. They then go out to the outer reefs to feed the corals. And those corals that house and feed the bigger fish. And then those bigger fish go on to feed the sharks. And that process never stops, perpetually happening. You know, I mean, that's an oversimplified version about this highly complex place that's exploding with life, you know, but essentially, that's it. It's just healthy, it's resilient, and has epic, strong shark populations that dominate, which means the reefs are healthy in order to support that. And, you know, the land goes off as well. We've been talking a bunch about the ocean today, but the land there is ridiculous. It's, you know, it's hard to even explain how many birds and crabs call Palmyra home. You literally have to watch every step you take, day or night. At night, you have to carry a flashlight because there are so many crabs just covering the pass. And there's also something like a million nesting seabirds that show up at Palmyra every year. And so their sounds and their presence are insane, truly. I mean, a little story, I remember waking up my first night there. It was like 3 a.m. And it sounded like there must have been thousands and thousands of birds directly over my cabin, flying around, squawking, screaming at each other relentlessly, you know? And I remember just laying there in my bed, smiling, because it was so loud and so ridiculous, you know? And so for me, Palmyra is just one of those last best places on Earth, and it was easy to put forward as a hope spot.
Thank you so much, Bryce. Chad, love to hear from you. As I mentioned earlier, TNC's been there for 20 years. I know you're working there. You're also a Hope Spot champion. Would just love to hear your thoughts on why this is such an important place for all of us.
Yeah, thank you, Lizzie. And I just, you know, we have to thank Palmyra, and we're here to celebrate Palmyra today. What a legendary group of people to be celebrating it. So thanks for the opportunity to share a little bit. I don't know that many people are familiar with where Palmyra Atoll is, even. I think if you Google Palmyra, you're probably going to go to Syria. So Palmyra Atoll is located about 1,000 miles south of Hawaii, 5 degrees north of the equator in the central part of the Pacific Ocean. And Palmyra is in the Line Island chain, which is primarily the nation of Kiribati. And for a long time, those Line Islands were huge volcanoes, 68 to 84 million years ago, there would be large islands throughout that chain. Today, they're coral atolls. That's what happens when the volcano subsides. The coral reef continues to grow for millions of years. So these are really elders in our world, these elder islands. And around 1,000 years ago, likely maybe 2,000, there would have been some Polynesian expansion through this part of the Pacific. It's likely that coconuts were brought to Palmyra at some point during that period. When the first European explorers sighted Palmyra in the first the 18th century and then early 19th century, 1804 is when Palmyra was named after a ship. And they did find coconut palms on the island, but not in any kind of a monoculture situation. There were all sorts of different hardwoods and plants and birds and crabs and fish and everything that we see today. And when the atoll really started to change was in the late part of the 19th century. A lot of those trees were cut down. Copra or coconuts were planted in monoculture for copra, for commercial activities. There were several ventures looking to commercialize the fisheries. And then as has already been shared in World War II, the atoll was blasted and dredged and filled and modified to meet the needs of wartime United States. So that's really a period where a lot of changes happened in a relatively short period of time. Up to 3,000 troops were stationed at Palmyra in about 600 acres of land. And the primary objective was maintaining national security. So everything else was secondary to that. And so when 1947, when the demobilization occurred as a result of a Supreme Court case, everyone just left. They left everything there. Some things were dumped into the lagoons, into pits. A lot of it was just left at Palmyra to be hidden and buried by the jungle, which grows so quickly. And for about 50 years, Palmyra was a place where maybe some people in the yachting community knew about, but it was unmanaged, untouched. And had all of these historic impacts that had occurred and really no plan for them. So in 2000, when the atoll was put up for sale by the family that owned it, there were some competing interests. There was a bid from for nuclear fuel storage, fuel rod storage, an idea to build a casino. And the Nature Conservancy saw the conservation potential of this place and purchased it. And a year later, worked with the Fish and Wildlife Service to protect 16,000 acres of coral reef. And then several years later, worked with the Fish and Wildlife Service, the Department of Interior, and NOAA to protect the oceans around Palmyra, which have been expanded for many parts of the Pacific. But Palmyra currently is in the middle of a 13 million acre marine protected area, a blue water marine protected area. So everything from the sharks to the tunas to the birds to the tiny fishes and the reefs are protected at Palmyra. And we've worked with partners and scientists since 2005 to study all of these things and to learn as much as we can. We've learned a lot. We have a lot to share. And we're really excited about this next phase where we're continuing to learn and to innovate from Palmyra to understand what healthy and resilient ecosystems look like. Because this is not a pristine place. This is a place that has been knocked down and punched hard and is getting back up again. And I think we can all take lessons from a place like Palmyra, no matter where we live and what our conditions are. So happy to share more about that today, but really excited to hear from everybody on this panel. Thanks, Lizzie.
Thanks so much, Chad. That was a wonderful history. I really appreciate it. You know, we've had a lot of great questions coming in the chat. Please keep them coming, guys. This one is from Eric in Iowa. Eric says, it's good to know Palmyra exists and that it's such a great place, but why should I care? I'm based in a landlocked Midwestern state, and I'd love to hear why a healthy atoll in the middle of the Pacific matters to me. Sylvia, love you to tackle this one. You're muted, Sylvia.
I was muting Sadie, my helpful dog. So it's a great question. I'm so glad it was asked. People ask all the time, why should I care about the ocean? If the ocean dried up tomorrow, what difference would it make to me? I've never seen the ocean, never touched the ocean. So what if the ocean dries up? Well, now we know the answer to that should be obvious to everyone. Now that we have seen Earth from afar, the world is blue, and it's not just rocks and water. It's alive from the surface to the greatest depths. It's the living ocean that shapes climate, weather, holds the greatest abundance of life on Earth. 97% of Earth's water is ocean. So whether you see or touch the ocean touches you with every breath you take, every drop of water you drink. Most of the oxygen you're breathing has come from life in the ocean through photosynthesis, generates oxygen, captures carbon, not only provides the basis of the great ocean food webs, but it's the basis of the principal carbon cycle, and it has been so through the beginning of life on Earth, that we need to thank the ocean for our existence. It's the most important thing that we extract from the ocean. People think, oh, the ocean, it's a place to go get the fish that I like to eat, or the shrimp, or the whatever it is. Actually, we need those living creatures in the ocean now more than ever to maintain Earth as a habitable place in a universe that is not very friendly. No ocean, no life. So thank you, ocean, for my and your existence.
Thank you, Sylvia. Pristine environments like Palmyra really give us a glimpse into the past, revealing what the ocean looked like before significant human impacts. And this is so important in a changing world, when we have all of the climate change impacts from increasing ocean temperatures to changing ocean chemistry. And coral reef atolls like Palmyra are literally on the front lines of climate change. So for many of us, we think of Palmyra as a living laboratory that help us to understand what is the ocean, how is the ocean responding to these climate impacts, and what is the role of a functioning, healthy ecosystem in the face of these climate impacts. I was on a call last night with some of my colleagues that spend a lot of their time working in Palmyra, and one of them shared something I wanted to just share with you today. He said, you know, Palmyra is our North Star. He said, in conservation, it helps us know what we're driving towards. It helps us show what healthy oceans can and should look like. And I just thought that was a really beautiful framing, and I wanted to share that with you. Chad, I'd love to hear from you. Can you talk about how Palmyra serves as a living laboratory for us, including some of the scientific innovations that have come out there that might be relevant to reefs and other places?
Absolutely. I am so fortunate to be able to work in a place like Palmyra where there is so much happening. There's so much abundance, and it really brings people together. And so one innovation that Palmyra is a part of is interdisciplinary research, bringing researchers together with different perspectives, different focuses, to look at big questions, big ecosystem questions, big nature questions, big questions about the role of science today. So several of the things that we're working on are democratizing our data. We want to make sure that everything that we learn at Palmyra is available to everyone else who wants to learn and understand the science and think about it from perspectives we haven't even considered yet. So that's incredibly exciting for us. There's been some video playing in the background, and thanks, Brett, for that, that shows teams from the Scripps Institution of Oceanography mapping the coral reefs of Palmyra and following those reefs through a thermal stress event. And we've recognized that Palmyra's reefs have been incredibly resilient to climate change, to rising ocean temperatures, and they are capable of being much the same before and after a massive bleaching event, which is a very uncommon occurrence. Important discovery. So what is driving those? And it's beyond the lack of local stressors. That's really important that we don't have a lot of dirty things going into the water, but we also have a lot of beneficial things happening that pelagic to land to coastal ecosystem that Bryce described so eloquently is a huge part of the ability of corals to feed when they're bleached. We know that they have the ability to store energy from eating, and to that can help them survive a bleaching event. And they also might be able to feed while their bones are showing. After they lose their symbiotic algae that turns sunlight into energy, they essentially starve to death. Really important discovery if we can understand how we can keep corals healthy and alive through bleaching events in addition to restoring them. Another super exciting innovation and is environmental DNA, being able to take a water sample and understand from that sample all of the life that's touched it. It's a rapid biodiversity assessment tool that can't be very well developed in places with a lot of complicated things in the water. In Palmyra, the water is full of life and not very much else. And so we're working with the University of California at Santa Barbara and researchers there to test environmental DNA as a method of biological assessments. And you know, other things are run the gamut from mosquito eradication. We don't necessarily want to have a lot of mosquitoes in places where mosquitoes are not important parts of the ecosystem. Palmyra is one such. And looking at the just the ability of a natural system to recover from impacts and some of and learning from all of our work as we care for Palmyra. And I could talk a little bit more about that later, but those are just some of the many innovations that happen when you bring good people together in a wild and abundant place where all those connections are intact.
Awesome, Chad, thanks so much. Bryce, I'd love to hear from you. What do you see as the biggest conservation success story in Palmyra and why?
Okay, well, I was hoping we'd talk about some of the rat eradication that went on there. That's such an incredible story. Maybe Chad can talk about that after, but I thought about this when you asked me this question, and essentially I think one of the greatest success stories is the actual collaboration that goes on there that Chad just talked about. You know, it's really unique for governments, NGOs, and universities to come together in such a way. And I think that's a big credit to Chad and all the people who work at the Nature Conservancy. You know, we need more collaboration in science, and it takes so much work to keep a place like Palmyra wild, you know? And the fact that so many groups can do that and are working together, I think is awesome. But I think it's important to talk for Chad, like to, maybe it's off topic, but I think it's awesome what happened when you guys eradicated the rats there and what came about from that, you know? Chad, I think you should tell that story.
Yeah, and full credit to the people who were very involved in that. That was a project that was co-led by the Nature Conservancy and Island Conservation and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. It took about 10 years to plan. And one of my colleagues, Dr. Alex Wegman, was the lead for that work. And the rats were introduced by the military, quite likely in the 1940s. They immediately began to have an impact on the native ecosystem. But at that time, there were so many other things happening that they weren't really considered the primary driver. After the dredging and blasting subsided, the rats were one thing that remained as an artifact of that time that were preying on crabs and seabirds and really altering that island. And so in 2011, with helicopters and people dangling from the bottoms of them to treat the trees and go into the old bunkers and explore the underground hospitals and all of the amazing parts of hidden parts of Palmyra where rats would live, all of the rats were eradicated. We took some measures to protect the shorebirds. The seabirds didn't seem to have much of an effect, but the rats went away. And almost immediately, we started to see at least two species of crabs that had not been seen on land prior to that. And then expansions in the range of a lot of the crabs, quite likely increases in the number of seabirds, but huge benefit to native or to all trees. A 5,000% increase in tree seedlings was observed by the researchers at Palmyra when the rats went away. And so now we have a virtuous cycle where we have more birds, more crabs, more nutrients on the land to feed the soil, to feed the forest, to feed the manta rays. And it's a great example of how we humans can do good things for nature. And that some of the things we can do can really give nature the ability to recover on her own.
Yeah, if I can just pop in that we blame the rats, but actually we should look in the mirror. We're the invasive species that brought the rats there. And it's basically solving a problem that we started. Another problem that is common around the world, but you can see evidence of good news in Palmyra, that the coral reefs in part are prospering because we allow the fish to be treated as wildlife in Palmyra. There's a study led by Jeremy Jackson looking at the Caribbean, and it applies to coral reefs around the world, that the impact of human predators on the fish, even small-scale fishing, but certainly the scaled-up level of extracting ocean wildlife, fish, sharks, grouper, snapper, part of the ecosystem that is essential to keep the corals healthy. The fish need the corals need the fish, as a part of the nutrient cycle that you've been talking about that is real. You take out the big fish, it's not only the destruction or modification of the food webs, but nutrients themselves that are just fine-tuned to be integral parts of the system. I love the study recently that was released by the International Monetary Fund about whales at the Davos, the World Economic Forum, early in 2020, about the carbon value of whales currently is on the order, just putting a dollar sign on it for climate, carbon value is $1 trillion. Just for the biomass, the carbon mass of whales. So if it works for whales, has to work for sharks, for tunas, for swordfish, for the fish behind the image that you're having right now, Chad, those surgeon fish that are cycling nutrients, carbon, of course, but by capturing and holding the carbon in place, not allowing it to escape into the atmosphere, which is what happens when we take millions of tons of ocean wildlife out of the sea, carbon dioxide, methane get released into the atmosphere instead of it staying in motion in the ocean, ultimately being stored for long periods of time in the deep sea. We are great disruptors. And we need to take that into account. And looking at the success of recovery at Palmyra, where all those carbon-based units that we call fish and crabs and birds and phytoplankton and zooplankton, the whole system that has taken gazillions of years to get into a kind of harmony that maintains Earth in a way that's favorable to us. Think of 4.5 billion years to create a planet that is hospitable for us and about 4.5 decades to unravel it significantly. So cause for hope, we can do this. If we make the right investments, make the right decisions, protect the natural systems, the way Nature Conservancy has been so helpful in showing the world what can happen when you give nature a break. So.
Well, thank you for that. And actually, that is so important to know and to understand is the role of carbon in all of this and the role of our actions in carbon. And fresh off the presses in peer review right now, but we do have a study underway looking at what happens when we transition a forest from coconut monoculture planted for copra back to a more natural, native, diverse plant assembly state.
All the pieces intact.
And there are carbon benefits. The soil carbon increases in the areas where you have a native diverse forest over that monoculture situation. The dissolved organic carbon, which actually is not beneficial to nearshore waters, that's released, decreases. So even by stewarding our land, I think the question from Iowa is beautiful. Taking care of the land wherever we are and making sure that land is being taken care of the way that it needs to be. Artificially doing it maybe doesn't work.
Planting native trees in your backyard and whatever belongs in that place helps put pieces of the puzzle back together again. And those crabs, I just love the focus that we have in those conversations and the images of crabs. People say, delicious when they think crabs. Many people do. But the crabs all crabs basically deserve our respect because of their their intrinsic value. And some of them, like the coconut crabs, with their big claws, live a long time. Claws big enough to crack coconuts and be a big part of the nutrient cycle. Amazing animals. We underestimate the invertebrates that really are the dominant forms of life on Earth.
Fisher, I think it's amazing that there were two species of crabs that were like hiding, the last 10 survivors of them hiding in the tall trees from the rats, you know, and science didn't even know they were there. And then once the rats were gone, they came out and now are flourishing. I mean, that's such a cool little story, you know?
It is.
Yeah, and I love the photos of the coconut crabs that are popping up here and there. And can we look at that again, Brett? Because that is just such an alien species to most of us who don't live on the Pacific Islands.
They think the same thing of humans, I'm sure.
they're amazing, amazing animals. And they're crawling around everywhere.
Coconut crabs, again, people eat them. And without really appreciating that they could be as old as your grandparents. And it just doesn't seem right that we should just make a 20-minute meal out of something that has taken decades to grow, and when you take them away, leaves a real gap in the ecosystem. I think no one should ever harm a coconut crab.
Thank you. I want to make sure we have some time to get to some of the questions that are popping up here in the chat. I've got one quickly here that I think Chad could perhaps answer for us. Has sea level rise been observed in Palmyra?
Yes. Well, I mean, Palmyra is on Earth, and so sea level rise has been observed here. One really fascinating piece of the sea level rise puzzle with atolls is that they're well conditioned to changes in sea level. They're have been for millions of years dealing with sea level fluctuations. And one of the primary components of the ability of an island, of any island, to withstand major sea level impacts is the health of its coastal ecosystem. Coral reefs ameliorate a lot of wave energy. That means that when, as surfers know, when waves break on reefs, a lot of their energy goes right there in that spot, and it doesn't hit the land as hard. As long as the corals can continue to grow around islands, they can really reduce a lot of the impacts of sea level rise to coastal erosion, to loss of shorelines. What reefs can't do is prevent oceans from rising up and pushing groundwater up on land in what's called like sunny day flooding, which we're seeing in parts of Florida, a lot of places actually throughout the world, that reefs can't save. But reefs can do a lot for places like Palmyra and Hawaii and Australia and other Pacific islands throughout the world by growing and protecting lands from waves. And as the soil gets rebuilt from the native forest on the land, everything grows. Everything grows together. So sea level rise is less of a stress for places that are intact.
Thanks, Chad. We have a question from Natasha, who says, what are the best roads for people to take that want to help with ocean conservation? Sylvia, love your thoughts on that.
Well, first, let me put in a good word for the seagrass meadows and the mangroves, and coupled with the coral reefs. Protect them, and sea level rise is ameliorated. And it's a really important part of the carbon cycle as well. So what can you do? Well, I suggest that you look in the mirror and ask yourself that question. No one can tell you any better than you can tell yourself what you have to give, what your talents are, what you care about. There are so many ways. No one can do everything, but if you do your part in the everyday choices you make about what to eat, what to wear, how you travel, or if you travel, and to use your talents, whether it's photography, music, art, away with kids, away with words, whatever it is, use that power in ways that will make a difference, whether it's in your backyard or in a hope spot 1,000 miles away. Support organizations like Nature Conservancy that are really in the front line of taking care of the planet that takes care of us.
Thank you, Sylvia, so much. Bryce, if you wanted to add something there too, I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I think that's it. It's all about our choices, right? Like how we bought, what we buy, what we wear, like Sylvia said, and realizing it matters. Each of all of our individual decisions make a big difference, you know? And I think people, when I also think people should attempt to get involved a little bit. And even if you live in the middle of America, you know, get involved in a group that's there working on rivers and lakes and forests or anything. And it's simple. People don't tend to do that, but when they feel like they can't have that connection to the ocean from so far away, but you really can when you realize it's all connected. And I think it's important. And I think that's part of Palmyra too. It shows how we as humans are also part of the chain, right? Like we haven't realized that yet. We're still operating outside that cycle for the most part, but by getting involved and being with some of these groups that are doing awesome restoration style work, I think you start to learn that innately and realize that we're part of the machine, and that's huge.
I think one of the pictures that has been shown in this presentation of trash on the beach in Palmyra, where did that come from? Probably came from many thousands of miles away, but it ultimately winds up in this amazing part of the planet. So be mindful.
Yeah. That blew my mind. That trash, you know, that picture I remember, Chad, was with me. It was sunrise, early morning. I walked to this part of the beach on my own and just having my own moment there. And Chad happened to follow up, and I just was sitting there realizing this incredible place we were in and how my mind was just blown of what was happening there. And then right there on the beach was this insane amount of pollution that, and Chad told me there's absolutely nothing we can do. You know, it's a daily ritual. And so here we are in this perfect world, and yet our footprint is all over that place at Palmyra. You know, it's amazing.
Yep. And I would love to hear from you too, Lizzie, who have created just an awesome career that's giving back to the planet in the marine conservation space. But first, I would say that for me, I think it's about looking inward. It really is. So looking in the mirror, looking into your heart, really understanding ourselves. I think we all have maybe not everyone on this panel, but I know I have a ton of work to do to really understand my impact, all of my impacts. And there's a reason that the plankton in the ocean create oxygen and absorb carbon dioxide. There's a reason that the plants do. This is our planet, and we're supposed to be living on it. And there is a way that we can live on it harmoniously. And so it doesn't mean you have to study coral reefs or speak out for conservation. Anything that we are doing and that we're called to do, you know, have a friend who would say, do what makes your heart sing. And if you're doing that, that's what the fish are doing. That's what the crabs are doing. That's what the birds are doing. They're doing what makes their heart sing, and it works. So if you're not doing that, then we're going to continue to struggle and to have these conflicts over time.
Thanks, Chad. That was a beautiful framing. I love that. I think for me, actually, I have a 13-year-old son, and he was doing a class interview last night, and he was asking me about my career path, and he was saying, Mom, you're a coral reef scientist, you know, why is it important? Like, what got you into it? And it really made me think back in my own life, what kind of drew me in. And I think at the end of it, he said, what's the one takeaway that you would share with my class? And I said, I think the most important thing we have to do is to get control of global emissions. I said, for me, climate change is our number one biggest issue. I've been working in ocean conservation for 2 decades, which is a small drop compared to others of us on this panel. But really getting climate under control, getting climate impacts under control, I think is mission critical. And I think whether that means, you know, pushing for policies that are reducing emissions, supporting renewable energy, you know, your vote that makes such a difference. We have a chief scientist at the Nature Conservancy. She is also a climate scientist from Texas. She was on Jimmy Kimmel a couple of weeks ago, and she said, you know, start a conversation about climate change. Less than 14% of people are talking about it. And if you start a conversation, you care. And if you care, you take action. So I think something's as simple as starting a conversation with our networks and our friends and our families about how important it is to tackle climate change, I think is something that we can all do that will be absolutely critical to protect our oceans and our Earth more broadly. I want to get into a question we had earlier in the chat too. I want to make sure we're getting as many of these as we can. This one was from Drew, who asked, the entire petroleum and oil industry is a multi-billion dollar industry, and the economies of many nations depend on it, but it's also destroying marine biodiversity severely. And no matter how many precautions we take, disasters are unpredictable. So how can we overcome and tackle this problem? So Sylvia, I'd love to hear your thoughts on how we tackle the challenges of the oil and gas industry and the impacts on our marine systems.
Well, I think we can attribute much of our current prosperity to the use of fossil fuels. It's propelled civilization into new levels of communication, taken us to the moon, be able to look back and see Earth from afar. But the greatest gift that we now have is for all that burning of fossil fuels is knowing we must change. Now we know what we could not know when we started down this track of extracting these ancient sources of carbon out of the deep ocean and out of the deep earth on the land. We have to change. We don't have a choice anymore if we are to survive. Now we know. It's the power of knowing that can and is leading to caring, that is causing us to shift to alternative means and to look as all of us can. It's not just, it really is important to shift gears to what is known as clean energy, that without the burning of fossil fuels. We know that the biggest source of energy comes from the sun, and tapping into it directly instead of indirectly through the 100 million year process of capturing and storing the carbon as oil and gas and coal. So now we know, but it's more than that. We have to also look at protecting the trees, the clear cutting of forests, the clear cutting of blue carbon from the ocean, the hundreds of millions of tons of sharks and tunas and swordfish and all the things that we lovely like to think of as, quote, seafood. That's blue carbon. We need to keep it in the ocean, keep the trees in the ground, replant trees, and try to restore health to places, not just like Palmyra. It's a great source of inspiration. But around the world, what can you do to restore the natural carbon capturing mechanisms, land and sea, and maintain that? Even if we succeed in bringing down the level of carbon dioxide and methane emissions and nitrous oxide emissions, it won't save or restore health to the planet in a long-term sense, unless we look at the natural systems and restore them too.
Thanks, Sylvia. This question is, I think, best for Chad. Chad, what can researchers and policymakers learn from Native Hawaiians and other Indigenous peoples about land and ocean stewardship?
That is an awesome question. Thank you to whoever asked that. That's such an important question, because when we talk about things like carbon emission reductions, we talk about local action to sequester carbon and to mitigate those impacts. We also have to acknowledge that there is a broader context for all of this, and that there's a justice lens that we can look at this through. There are people who have lived harmoniously in the world for thousands of years and developed sustainable lifestyles, sustainable life ways, who are living in areas that when we scientists get there, we're blown away. Look at all this life. Look at all this abundance. Look at all this diversity. What a pristine place. Humans have not just discovered these places. Humans have been in these places for a very long time and have adapted a life way that is compatible with the abundance that we would all love to see. And so if Palmyra is a North Star, it's on one end of a spectrum. There are other places that are within that spectrum that are also teeming with life and with abundance. And we're all somewhere along that spectrum, from healthy, intact ecosystem that's inspiring to the world, to fully degraded ecosystem that where action is desperately needed. Indigenous lifeways, indigenous connections to nature, the kinship that people feel and experience to all of the life around them is another way of looking at what Sylvia is saying, that every life form is important. They all have a personality. We're completely dependent on the life of this planet for our own lives. And so it really is, to me, we're all indigenous to planet Earth. And the people who have maintained that connection have a lot to teach us. Those of us who have been able to separate from that connection for various reasons over the last several generations have a lot we can learn from those who have not.
Thank you, Chad. This one just popped in from Victoria, who is applied for a volunteer position at Palmyra. Thank you, Victoria. And she's asking about what is the one experience you would most want a visitor to have on the atoll? So I'm going to start with you, Bryce. You're muted, Bryce.
The one experience. I think some fun, I was just thinking of things we haven't talked about there. And I love the fact that, you know, I think Chad should tell the story of the sooty terns that you were arguing with, trying to keep them off the runway at Palmyra. I love that. And I love the idea. I'm just thinking of different awesome aspects of Palmyra. You have to freeze your clothes at home before you leave. And then when you get there, you also have to freeze your clothes when you get there to protect from bringing in any invasive species, you know? And I'm thinking at night, like, I remember when we sit around talking story at night at the end of the day, and we're right there on the dock, and there are manta rays that are literally in 2 feet of water coming right up to the shoreline as we were sitting. I mean, they were part of the discussion with us. And yeah, what else? As far as an experience, I think just being there is what you have to. It starts when you land on the crushed coral runway, right? You get off the plane, stepping on a bunch of crushed coral. No one's ever landed on a coral runway. And for me, it just started there. Like, every single aspect of being in Palmyra is a magical experience.
Thanks, Bryce. Sylvia, love your thoughts as well.
I think you've seen it in the images with being in the midst of at least 1,000 surgeon fish, those stripy fish that are like those behind Chad in that image. And, you know, I thought I was going there to look at the fish, realizing they came over to look at us, to look at me. And you can see in that image right there, they're not swimming away. They're swimming toward me. They're looking at me, and they're just curious, just as I'm curious about them. It's one of the great revelations, I think, about getting into the water with life in the sea, instead of just being in a little boat on the surface or looking from the land or looking at a fish on your plate in a restaurant or in the supermarket, but to get acquainted with them and to see that every face is unique. Like every crab, like every human, every cat, every dog, we're experiencing this miracle of great diversity coupled with the commonality that the recipe for life across the board is alike, that we have so much in common with every little coral polyp and every bird. The chemistry of life is so similar, but with this special capacity to diversify right down to the individual creature. No Chad, like the Chad Wiggins we're looking at right now.
Chad, what about you? What is the one experience you think every visitor should have on Palmyra?
You gotta go to Crabtown when you go to Palmyra. Crabtown is where if we have any food waste, we put it in a particular place on the atoll and magically turns into bigger crabs. And they will come, you'll hear the bushes rustling as the crabs get excited. They will come out of the woodwork, and at its peak, Crabtown can be, you know, a couple hundred crabs deep of just pure life taking care of all of our food waste. I think One of our science volunteers, which is a really important program we have for growing the next generation of conservation leaders, suggested that every mall in America and on Earth should have a crab town for all of the food waste. So what an efficient system. There's no trace of it afterward. Although we try not to create it, you gotta go to crab town when you come to Palmyra.
It's called recycling in action.
Exactly, that's awesome. Thank you guys. This has been such a fantastic conversation, and I'm so grateful to all of you for making time to call in and to our wonderful panelists today. I think we heard about the importance of Palmyra as a learning laboratory. We heard about the importance of resilience and letting systems recover and the impacts that humans can have, but the incredibly powerful potential for nature to heal. I think that's just such an inspiring story for us. And it really is, it does guide us as our North Star in our ocean conservation work. I think you also heard about some exciting ideas about why we should all be trying to get to Palmyra. And I saw there's a couple of extra notes in the chat about people wanting to be in marine science or how to be a scientist or work at the Nature Conservancy. We're certainly happy to share materials after the call about that. And also some folks asked how they can watch and access the video. So we'll try to share a link. Bryce will figure out if we can share that as part of this. But we're definitely going to be sharing after this event, a link to this event. And we'll be in touch. We're going to try to keep doing these. This has just been a wonderful way for us to hear from all of you and to share some of the great conservation work happening around the world. So we'll share the invitation to the next one and whatever links we can include in there. But really just wanted to express our gratitude for spending your time with us and hope you have a wonderful rest of your day and a wonderful weekend. Thank you so much and have a great one. Appreciate it.